cars with tinted windows, the bright lights and press cameras, the red carpet under my feet, Robert Plant and a badge with my name on it, Jessy Easton, publicist. The badge hangs from a lanyard around my neck at the Grammys. The dream had made it out of my head. A girl from a California desert town on the edge of nowhere, a town where dreams die the moment they begin to surface. There is no air. There is no light. A town for settling, for giving up, and for being too scared to dream in the first place. I was scared, not of the dreaming, but of the not getting out. I didn't know when or how exactly, but I knew my dreams would free me. So I held on to them until my knuckles went white. Dreams of the city skylines, of record labels on the Sunset Strip, of opportunities only given to those better than me. Those who came from somewhere worth coming from. Maybe from a family who ate dinner together, or a family with a healthy savings account. Or maybe from a family who read heavy books and had plaques of accomplishments on the walls of their home office. Maybe a family who had an office at all. Not my family. We didn't eat dinner together. Living on a diet of sugar and methamphetamines, my parents couldn't stomach a home-cooked meal. We didn't have an office or any plaques. Dad never finished high school. Mom had college offers, but she could never sit still long enough to care. My brother Brandon was studying for his GED and working at the dump because he never dared to dream. I didn't care about the dinners, or the money, or the lack of it. At least we had each other, which was better than before. Back when we were kids and Dad would disappear into the meth lab he'd built in our garage while Mom served out felony charges in prison. That was a dark and quiet time, and my infant-like dreams were barely flickering. But even with all that we lacked, there was one thing my family always had. Music. Mom and Dad would rock out to Led Zeppelin while I was still in the womb. When we were kids, we'd sing Black Dog at the top of our lungs and feel the buzzing in our bones from the 18-inch woofers Dad had stacked in every corner of the living room. When I was in high school, Mom would turn the volume up full blast in the car and headbang at every stoplight on her way to the mall. It was the music that kept the dreaming alive. The music was my way out. It all happened so fast, the getting out. It started with a tiny moment, one as light as air, that would later hold the weight of everything to come. The sun was high in the sky, white like paper, and the soles of my feet were burning in the sand. The sound of the ocean in my ear, I shifted my weight from one foot to the other and waited for the band to arrive. A secret show. No one was supposed to know about it, but I knew, because I spent every waking moment on the internet looking for a way out. The Huntington Beach Pier. I forgot sunscreen. My brother came with me. Maybe a part of him was looking for an escape after all. We'd driven 100 miles to the sea in my used Oldsmobile, the color of dust-covered cherries, squinting in the shimmering heat, drenched in salt and sand in anticipation. I waited. I waited for something to happen, and something did. I noticed two girls, one dark-haired and one blonde. They each carried a guitar case. By the way they teetered and sloshed through the sand, I could tell the guitars were heavy. The girls looked young, not as young as I was, but young enough that I wanted to know how they got the job carrying guitars. Hitting Brandon on the arm, I told him I was going to introduce myself. When he asked why, I told him because I wanted to do what they did. "What do they do?" he asked. I didn't know exactly, but I knew it was something. "I'm Jessy," I said, extending my hand like I was someone worth knowing. Wide-eyed with bottomless nerve, I told them about my good grades and my acceptance into a university 5 minutes from the coast, about my dreams of working in the music industry and how I would have no problem carrying guitars. "I'm stronger than I look," I said. They laughed. "Oh no, we're not roadies or anything like that. We're in marketing," they said, handing me their card. I held it in my sweating hands and studied it against the glare of the sun. It was thick and black with Atlantic Records sprawled across the top in red lettering. Strategic marketing and brand partnerships. I had no idea what that meant, but I knew I could do it. You should come by and see us, the dark-haired girl said. Yeah, we could use someone like you, the blonde said. Someone like me. I'd never had a real job. Besides babysitting in a holiday season, slinging retail at the mall, I'd never done a damn thing. Someone like me. I came from nowhere and didn't have a dime. Someone like me. On our way back to the desert, we ran out of gas. Sunburned, dehydrated, and stranded on the side of the road, we sat in the car, tossing a beach ball back and forth while we waited for Dad to pick us up. He never came. The day darkened, and I pulled the card out of my wallet. Atlantic Records. A real record label. The label that had signed Zeppelin back in 1968. A ticket to freedom.